Hello and welcome to another episode of Business on the Wire. Even as the economy begins its attempt to kickstart proceeds and activities across the nation, there seems to be a slew of changes that have come about, particularly with regard to what's happening on labor laws. In the course of the last few days, several state governments, many of them run by the ruling party, which is the BJP, came out with some sweeping changes that connect with the labor, and many of them have met with sharp criticism, while parts of industry have said that these look like very salutary changes and will indeed bring in a lot of reform. Where does the truth lie, and what are the main areas of contention around many of these changes? Joining me to debate and discuss that are two gentlemen, Professor Shyam Sundar, who's an eminent labor economist and a professor at XLRI, and Mr. Pradeep Bhargav, who was formerly president of the Employer Federation of India and also past chair of the CII National Committee on Industrial Relations. Gentlemen, thank you both for joining in. Professor Sundar, if I can come to you first, just to set a little bit of context on what's going on here. You know, I'm going to put out what is known in terms of the intent behind this, and then we can walk through what exactly has happened. Let's start with one state government first, the Uttar Pradesh government, which approved an ordinance exempting businesses from the purview of almost all labor laws for the next 3 years, ostensibly to give a fillip to investment in the state. What exactly has happened in that ordinance, and what stays and what has been removed from the labor laws?
First of all, thank you, Mitali, for inviting me for this program. See, the Uttar Pradesh government has issued an ordinance on three grounds, justifying the ordinance on three grounds. Number one, the COVID-19 has posed an extraordinary crisis in both the economy and the labor market. And secondly, there is a very popular argument now that in these difficult times, and particularly given the antagonism that is mobilized against China, the spaces that the product market spaces that have been vacated by China should be occupied by India. That is the second kind of national legitimacy, which applies to UP as well. And third one, it says that liberalization or complete exemption of most of the labor laws will help investments to flow in to Uttar Pradesh, and thereby there would be economic revival and at the same time creation of jobs. And these are the three assumptions that underlie the move by Uttar Pradesh. But I'm afraid, but these are extremely misplaced assumptions. And if we go through the ordinance, it applies to factory sector alone. That is, the factories registered under the Factories Act, including the manufacturing processes. Now, we all know that, labor laws, on the one hand, it is recognizing only the factories. On the other hand, investment has been more into service sector rather than in the factory sector. So I'm not sure how this move, particular liberalization, will help Uttar Pradesh government to achieve. More importantly, it is not the labor law rigidities that have been constraining investment inflows. There are other economic aspects of ease of doing business, like extensive infrastructure, high availability of person power. In fact, I must add here, Tamil Nadu, Gujarat, and NCR and Maharashtra have largely succeeded in getting all the foreign direct investment, primarily because they had infrastructure. They have infrastructural facilities, skilled person power. Apart from other advantages, UP, in my opinion, does not have many of these advantages. I just checked at the annual survey of industries 2016-17. There are just about 12,000 factories. So employing less than 8 lakh workers. Now, is this an economic justification? Now, as a labor economist, I should point out that among the constraints that would affect investment flows, labor law rigidities will not be counted among the top five. It is the skilled person power and various other economic aspects which I mentioned earlier. So the Uttar Pradesh government must rather look at revamping the skill development program and also restructure the educational institutions, particularly ITIs and others, to make available a large pool of surplus person power. Why do people from UP migrate? The very fact that millions of workers migrate from Uttar Pradesh because of any other factor. There are very, very highly skilled people. Several of them are unskilled people. And the very fact that they are migrating attests to the fact that there is something wrong in the way the economic policies and labor laws are being envisaged and administered.
Right. So let me get some industry.
And the most dangerous
conversation before I come back to you, Professor Mr. Bhargav. As the professor pointed out, there seem to be some sweeping changes, including to industrial dispute resolution. Many have also pointed out that this is in violation of the Factories Act. It's contrary to the conventions of what the ILO had set out. Is this truly what industry wanted? Are these the kind of changes that you wanted?
Okay, Mithali, let me, for a moment, keep Uttar Pradesh notification on the back burner, simply because it's a 1.5-page shoot in the announcement that laws are suspended. I'm sure they will come out with further clarifications as we move. I think Madhya Pradesh notification is a case in point to the question that you're raising. Madhya Pradesh notification is a lot more detailed. It defines what it will do and what it will not do. And I think it's important for us for a moment, I think one proposition. Every time when somebody comes out, and that's our problem, every time when somebody comes out with something which is positive to business, we presume and assume that it is against labor. What is good for business doesn't have to be against labor, and that's a mindset that we need to get. Activists and everybody starts getting into that mode. Let me just briefly analyze for you Madhya Pradesh notification. Mithali, it will throw light completely. 80% of what Madhya Pradesh government has announced is ease of doing business. It has nothing to do with labor. And we're calling it labor reforms. Actually, it's not. When they say an inspection will not happen to the industry if it is non-hazardous, less than 50 people, it has nothing to do with labor. All that they're saying is industry, guys, let them work. Government has no business to go and inspect. Third-party inspection is allowed. When they say inspection will happen only with the permission of the labor commissioner, all that they're saying is there'll be no harassment. When they are saying the definition of factory is defined in terms of 20 or 40, it has nothing to do with labor. When Contract Labor Act allows contractor to register less, it has nothing to do with labor. When change shift happens or when 72 hours happens, these are all ease of doing business, none of them. I'll come to your point. 8 out of the 10 points have nothing to do with labor. They've got to do with ease of doing business, which is due. In fact, it's not labor reform, it's a government reform. Government for once has realized they don't need to interfere at no cost to the labor. Yes, there are two elements. One is the Industrial Dispute Act and second is the IR Act. What is the Industrial Dispute Act amendment that Madhya Pradesh saying? He says, guys, sort out things amongst yourself. Labor courts and government don't come to us unnecessarily. Great mechanism. In any case, you look at the pending cases, in fact, of factories dispute in labor courts, unbelievable. Only lawyers benefit. Factories and employees, this is sort of common to say. Industrial Relations Act, what modification they've done that no single union can dominate. So, ma'am, all these things are really improving governance, improving giving the things. They've preserved Workmen's Compensation Act, they've preserved Bonded Labor Act, they've preserved Payment of Wage Act, they've preserved Building and Contract Works Act, they've preserved minimum wages. Everything has been preserved. What relates to labor in their safeguards, safety is preserved. What they have done, Madhya Pradesh, completely, is making it easier for people to do business. When business does, ease of doing business is not ease of harassing workers. And I think this is really brought up. Uttar Pradesh, I reserve my comments because I don't know the details. They haven't come up with the details. Madhya Pradesh has come out with that argument and articulation, which clearly spells out, guys, do it. Now, I don't see why. I don't see why people should react and call it draconian. I don't see why people should call it, I mean, you asked a question, does it think minimum wage is not affected? Overtime is being given when working hours are being extended. Social security is being preserved. None of those things affecting workers is being changed in this law. All that is saying, government will leave industry alone. And I think that's a good point. That's a perspective I want to bring to you.
Professor, do you want to come in on that with the added point of the fact that while there may not have been changes in terms of wages per se, there do seem to be changes both in terms of safety standards as also in terms of sanitation standards and ventilation?
No. First, I want to make a very respectable differences with what Mr. Bhargava have said. Does it mean, changing the thresholds of Factories Act or Contract Labour Act, does it not do with the labour? You are, the government is telling that by amending the thresholds, so many thousands of workers will be out of the purview of the acts. If they are out of the purview of the acts, these workers will be at the mercy of the employers and they will have no recourse to claim their right. So amendment of thresholds is not just for business. Any law, any changing of the law and changing the thresholds will leave out larger number of workers out of the purview of the law, and which will create what is called Raj. But let me come to the Madhya Pradesh about which Mr. Bhargava said. Industrial dispute act, excepting 5B, exempted. That means the workers, the bipartite committees need not be constituted. Conciliation machinery, there is a huge question mark about the conciliation machinery. And given the low degree of union coverage in a state like UP, for India, the union coverage is less than 15%. Imagine if 100 workers are employed in UP, 85 workers are not unionized. Then how do workers enjoy the bargaining power? And the case will be worse in the case of UP. So there is no union coverage. There is no legal coverage. And the workers are asked to have a dialogue with the employers. And the bargaining power of the workers, we all know, without the union will be very less. And the Factories Act exempts, excepting the safety provisions, all the welfare facilities, sanitation, drinking water, urinals, latrines, temperature, conditions of work. Conditions of work will be left to the mercy of the employers, and we know sweatshops exist in garment industry, in various other industries, electronic industries. There's a huge supply chain. How can one say that these laws have no relevance for workers? These laws will, and they deprive the right to have the dispute settlement. And it is well proven economic logic. And if the workers are discontent, then it will affect the productivity and thereby the economic efficiency. But I also wish to bring in ILO here. India is a signatory to 39-40 ILO conventions, and one of them is C-144, tripartite consultation with regard to international labor standards, which requires the union government and the state governments to hold a social dialogue with the employers' bodies and the trade union organizations. But these ordinances have been issued unilaterally. Inspections have been done away, and we have ratified labor inspection convention G1, requires as frequent as necessary inspections to ensure compliance of labor law. And to me, this Uttar Pradesh ordinance, which I have gone through, and the Madhya Pradesh by exempting, and these are the demands which the employers would not even called for. They, according to me, unleash labor market anarchy, and I'm afraid that this virus of labor flexibility will be far more dangerous than the COVID virus, because it will impact not only workers in the unorganized sector who are not covered by these labor laws, but also the organized sector. And ILO talks about formalizing informality. Yeah. Now UP and Madhya Pradesh are doing the exerting the reverse, informalizing formality. How is it? How can one accept that? How can the labor rights, which have been constructed over 150 years, be blown away by two ordinances?
Let me go to Mr. Bhargav. Part of this conversation. Because, the argument that these changes in labor laws were ostensibly to attract more investment and, of course, to make India an alternative hub to China. You've been tracking this space for a long time, sir. You've been part of the team that goes to the table and has these conversations. In your experience, does foreign money or do foreign investors want to come and invest in a situation where laws are more diluted or where they are clear? Because, they generally seek extreme hygiene and extremely high ethical standards, particularly when it relates to labor. Do you think this is a step in the right move for that ostensible goal of attracting more investment?
Could I start? Yeah?
Yes.
I lost a lot of what Professor said because the voice wasn't very clear, but let me answer your question, and I'll just, with your permission, answer the last part of his thing. So, of course, he has his argument. This business of flexibility, which is being given to the employer, is a very, very major issue raised all the time that we should. Tell me, ma'am, and tell me, Professor, when I run an enterprise, if my business goes down, I reduce my orders on suppliers. There is no law which says keep the supplier order the same, whether the business goes up or down. When I'm running an enterprise, I borrow from the bank. There's no law which says that you have to keep doing the same borrowing, whether you need it or not. It's only in case of an employee, you suddenly say, whether the business goes up or down, you need to keep the employment there. This is a very, very strong basic dynamics which you need to acknowledge. And the flexibility, particularly today, even before Corona came, 4.0 was creating huge challenges for us. There was this question whether some business will stay. Today, the business future itself is at stake. When business is not permanent, how can they be talking about giving permanence to workforce? And when I use the word permanence, it's about flexibility that Professor talked about. I think we need to understand, even foreign investment, Indian investment, I don't make a distinction between them. Look for an environment where they have a certain flexibility to operate. Flexibility does not mean abuse. Flexibility does not mean compromise on safety standard. Flexibility does not mean not having social security. Flexibility means how many people can I have. In that case, I think foreign investment, when they come, they look for transparency, what you rightly said, they need for clarity. They also need the ability for a business to operate in changing business dynamics. We have today, believe me, I'm talking to virtually enterprises every single day in my role. People are saying, I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I have no idea about my business. I don't know what is going to be asked for. And if you're going to tell me that I can't have any flexibility, I can't have any freedom with one of the critical resources, it's not going to be fair. Will this mean foreign investment will come? The question that you posed, this is one of the factors. And Professor was very right in saying, labor laws are only one part of it. Infrastructure, ability to access, and the sanity and judiciary, the ethics of the governance is important. I would rest my case by saying, these labor laws will, believe me, go for some tweaking to bring in elements of safety, security, social security, and hygiene. With that is added, I think we should be allowing industry to run the enterprises in the manner they deem fit, because it's their survival is at stake much before employee survival comes.
One point of criticism that has also come in from people who support these labor changes is that it only served unionized labor, which is a very small fraction of Indians in the formal sector. I'm reading out from one, senior research fellow at Mercatus Rights also that, and in these times, the poor prefer to have some work, and champagne socialists insist that no jobs at prevailing minimum wage is better than some jobs at a lower market wage. So it's better to remove minimum wage. How would you respond to these points of argument? The fact that these labor laws were addressing only a very small fraction of the labor that we address in India, and that perhaps, as she has put it, it's time to let everyone behave as adults and, let it be a more open system.
Yeah, the game of pitting unorganized workers against the organized worker has been going on for quite some time. In fact, labeling the workers in the unorganized organized sector as labor aristocracy. Now, what is laws? What is the organized sector? Organized sector is one, according to National Commission for Enterprises in the unorganized sector, is one which is covered by labor laws and which have employment and social security. And if these are fundamental rights of any workers, and if the government or the industry are so keen to protect the welfare of the unorganized workers, why is the government not introducing universal social security or unemployment allowance and effectively implement the Unorganized Workers Social Security Act? The Unorganized Workers Social Security Act is one of the most poorly implemented acts in India. How can one talk about abolition of minimum wages? Are we going back to 19th century? 150 years have passed by, and we are in a modern situation wherein the labor standards should rise. And let me also tell you the economic theory: good capital will chase good high labor standards, not the vice versa. China is not a comparator. Bangladesh is not a comparator. Investments will flow only when the employers are assured that they could have a dialogue with recognized trade unions and labor standards are good, and the product, and as a result, the productivity will increase, economic efficiency will increase, and thereby they could also benefit and the country could also benefit. But what has been done in the name of labor law reforms, in the name of affording labor flexibility to employers, the government is weakening the labor standards. And that is my primary concern. There are three primary concerns that I want to share. Number one, the government is informalizing formality, informalizing formal sector by vast exemptions, sweeping exemptions. Number two, the government is not doing enough to ensure welfare of the vast majority of unorganized workers, namely social security or food security. Thirdly, the government is also violating a number of ILO conventions, whether it is tripartite consultation or labor inspection convention or employment policy convention. So these are very serious ones. I believe that there must be a middle path. Yes, I understand. I appreciate Mr. Bhargav's concerns that employers do require flexibility because of the volatile product market. But the kind of changes that have been made, it looks like throwing the baby with the bathwater. I mean, you provide a labor flexibility to the extent that the employers want. Mm. And if the employers are not well fed and if they are not well taken care of, according to the efficiency wage theory, workers will not be able to consume nutritious food. Their physical and emotional capabilities will be less, and as a result, they will be less productive. And will employers benefit from these sweatshop regime that the vast sweeping changes that have been made by UP and Madhya Pradesh? And how on earth? I mean, the paradigm is that the state will remove itself from the scene. There will be no labor laws. Individual workers deal with the employers directly. If you are lucky, you have a union, and unions need state support. And this kind of a paradigm takes us back to 19th century. And I think it is a very unfortunate historical reversal.
Mr. Bhargav, let me, you know, sort of simplify that to, you know, an observation which people have made, which is that everyone understands the need for industry to have more independence in terms of its functioning. Could there not have been any attempt at a tripartite forum discussion? I mean, why were these sweeping changes made where there was no industry, workers, government sitting together and going through any of this ranking?
I have personally been party to large number of tripartite forums. The central government does it. There have been, with every act and court bill that gets generated, there is, again, the government organizes tripartite discussions. First of all, to be honest with you, there is no unanimity amongst the industry employer bodies as to what they want. There is certainly no unanimity in the trade unions. And the government ultimately finds that there is nothing like emerging. I have gone through the huge amount of discussions on the four courts. Every single tripartite, including hearing with the standing committee of the parliaments, etc. It's going tinkering with the things that's been going on for in 2019. When this government came to power in 2014, they had announced these four bills, if you remember the ports. It's 2020. Not only one has been passed. It's a very painful process on the thing. And I do acknowledge the fact that it could have been resolved bilaterally, but tinkering with the same thing isn't something radical. You remember the import policy regime at one point of time? There's to be schedule 2A, 3B, if you import into this. Till one day government says, everything will be allowed for import except items identified. We have come to a situation where they say, we will introduce laws which are required rather than continuing to tinker with the thing. And I again want to, Vitali, want to bring one point. It looks like assumption is that the employers don't understand the value of a satisfied employee, committed employee, trained employee, welfare employees. It looks like as though the employers are a set of exploiters. They are the losers if the employee is not satisfied and employee is not well taken care of. Why would the employer be stupid enough to treat his workforce badly and continue to do it? There are some. Absolutely right, there are some. But to label every employer as an exploiter, in non-sensitive. You know, this COVID brought out the thing beautifully. I'll just illustrate it to bring home the point. There were large, I won't name the organization, there was one big, well-respectable group who is into construction business said, I'm going to pay to my every worker even though there is zero construction. 150 crores a month was the salary bill that employer paid because he knew this was going to be there.
We lost you for a second. You're back now. Yeah.
I'll be very crisp. Other construction builders decided to say, mere paas kaam nahi hai, toh I will not take anybody. Now, what's happened? The migrant workers who are working for this group, which is stable, looks at long term, are still there when they start construction. The others who chose to treat them flippantly are going to struggle for labor. So, ma'am, there is a business case for being caring. There is a business case for being fair. There is a business case for being ethical. Some people who don't understand are short-term runners. Let's understand that industry has to be sensitive. And I take professor's points completely that there are opportunities for exploitation. 95% of workforce is unorganized anyway. What are we doing about them? And I totally support his point that universal social security has to come in. That's the only answer. Playing around with this 5% and putting a whole lot of restrictions on them will only make this 5% become 2%. That's all.
I take your point too, Mr. Bhargav, but surely it cannot be a matter of faith on, you know, expecting the employer to do the good thing and the right thing. In that case, we should remove all traffic norms as well. But since we are out of time, let me just ask the professor, you know, the last question. Where from here, professor? Because at this point, it's an ordinance, but labor is a concurrent subject. Do you expect the center to step in at this point or does it look like a done deal?
No, the center is not going to step. You see, this is the political economy of labor law reforms. At the national level, they are not able to implement because of tremendous opposition by the central trade unions. So it has cleverly shifted the labor law reforms mandate onto the state governments where the trade unions are not acted as they are at the national level. So it is the state governments. And I see first the Madhya Pradesh and then Uttar Pradesh. I'm told it is Gujarat. I won't be surprised if many others. Now, my request is that liberalizing labor laws without consultation of the stakeholders and providing that they would bring foreign capital into India. Are totally misplaced assumptions that the government is fancying. To me, this will lead to race to bottom of labor standards. Today only, the ILO's report has come, nearly 1.6 billion workers will be rendered informal positions, and the vast majority of informal workers will be the ones who will be affected. If the government is very serious, let it not tinker with the labor laws concerning the organized sector. Let them do with the for the unorganized sector. Let them demonstrate their commitment to unorganized to workers. But let me also appreciate Mr. Bhargav's statement. Self-governance will hold good in the case of will rational economic employers are very few, very scarce. There will be labor market opportunism. The very fact that the labor laws came into picture is to curtail the natural economic incentive to use opportunistically to lower the labor standards and try to maximize profits. The low labor cost globalization model is the dominant model, and that is why we are seeing this. What I mean, can we believe that company, I won't name the companies, big automobile companies based in Pune and in Manesar have used NEEM trainees during the strike, and NEEM trainees are the contract workers are asked to do regular work on the shop floor, whereas the Contract Labor Act specifically exempts. NEEM trainees are students, they cannot be called as workers. So let us not forget the fact that the proportion of contract workers have risen from less than 10% to nearly 36%. In fact, in Uttar Pradesh, 36% of the workers are contract workers. Believe me, this is an underestimate. This is the government data, annual survey of industries. There is also a very reputed company in Jamshedpur where I live. 60% of the total workers are contract workers. Now, why is this happening? Why this contractization, precaritization, and using NEEM trainees and earn and learn workers for the core production processes? There is a huge labor market opportunism that even the so-called economically rational employers do. So in these times of testing times and this neoliberalization model of low labor cost, labor laws must be strengthened and they should not be diluted. And the government must introduce three things: occupational security, universal occupational security, universal social security, and unemployment allowance. And I blame the government because it shifts the entire unemployment benefits onto the employers, asking them to pay severance pay under the Industrial Dispute Act, which is a pittance, 15 days of wages for every year of completed service. Why is the government not bringing out unemployment allowance, universal unemployment allowance scheme, even after 18 years? Second National Commission on Labor has recommended it. So I believe to sum it up, to me, in the name of COVID-19, in the name of labor shortages, in the name of occupying China, the space vacated by China, the governments are introducing uncalled for sweeping changes in labor laws, which takes us to 19th century labor market model, where the individual worker had to negotiate with the individual employer and thereby getting exploited. There may be good employers. I'm sure there are good employers. I know many of them, but vast majority will take advantage. And I'm repeating, labor laws are there to prevent labor market opportunism and labor exploitation.
Okay, gentlemen, we'll have to wrap it there. Thank you both for weighing in with your thoughts.
I mean, and the labor standards provide a model which India need to adhere to. Thank you very much.
Thank you both so much for weighing in with your
thank
thoughts.
Thank you so much.
Like a thorny road ahead, but I appreciate both of you joining in today. Thank you.